Smith Realizer. Looks like Smythe, but it's not, it's Smith. And I haven't heard of this Smith fellow or this device, hadn't heard of it until recently. We had an AES meeting and essentially Wade Bray of Auchinhead was telling what wonderful results it has, but how it works even better in terms of imagining what this binaural head system has if you're looking out a window or have some kind of a, even looking at a TV or have some kind of visual perspective that allows you to think about the sound coming out of your head. And a lot of people have real trouble with wearing headphones like is required for this binaural system. They say the sound is in head locatedness, it's spacious, but it's all in their head, or it's behind them, or something like that. Is everybody familiar with what I'm talking about, or this kind of problem? Everybody know what binaural is? Yeah, I should say anybody got a problem with it, or want to ask me a question about it. Well, at any rate, somebody saw our SMODEMS meeting on YouTube, and they asked if we had heard of this Smith Realizer that addresses, and as far as he's concerned, fixes this problem. And that's Randy, who I'm speaking in place of today. And so he offered to come and give a presentation. Well, he's not here, so, but he did send the Smith, and I've been playing around with it, which it seems more like work than play. It's a lot of work to set it up, involving microphones in your ears, and they're so supposed to be in your favorite listening position, but the realizer itself is across the room in the other position, and lo and behold, it turns out it's easier if there are actually two people to do it, one to read the screen and operate the remote, another to wear microphones in their ears or headphones or whatever. At any rate, I took a shot at it. It took me over 3 hours to get something that really made sound but didn't work right. Then David Carlstrom came over and helped out, and took 2 hours of us, a two-man team, to put my ear connections into the memory. And after we learned how to do it, it got faster. And probably, if it was the only thing I did for a week or two, I could do it in about 15 minutes. But it is quite a challenge to set up. And what does it do? Well, I'm just going to let the slides guide me, and hopefully if you don't have any questions, this will do it. I think they're going to guide me. Okay, there's the realizer, that thing in the box in the center. The Stax headphones are to the right, clamped over their box, and there's a little box on top of the headphones and a receiving box on top of the realizer, a remote, and bags full of headphones and or bags full of microphones that go in your ears. Okay, so what is a realizer? Multi-channel audio processor for headphones. You'd think, well, why not just put the headphones on and listen to them, but there are problems with that for some people. Spaciousness, it's spacious but sounds all inside my head is a common complaint. Another one is sounds are supposed to be, that are supposed to be in front of me actually come from behind me. And the third one is the entire orchestra turns when I turn my head. So I'm wearing these headphones, I turn, the orchestra went from here to over here. And this is very disconcerting to many people. That happens with all normal headphones. So there's some real problems if you want precision listening. I'd add another one to this myself and say that if you get a good recording of some music, you know, classical music, modern music, whatever kind, chances are it was mic'd and mixed and processed while listening to speakers and listening to, it's made for speakers. And if you just pump it directly into headphone terminals, you're missing that speaker room connection, the mixing of the sound between the two ears and so forth. So there's almost nothing that is made for headphone listening, except binaural. Why not binaural? It's good, but it's not the realizer. So the realizer allows listening to any playback source in a remote loudspeaker and room in real time over headphones. So that is, once I've done this calibration, which I did in my own listening room, like let's say it was like this, I sat back here with microphones in my ears and went through this procedure where sound came out of my speakers and played into these microphones that are in my ear canals. And then I did another thing of putting the headphones that I was going to use on my head and going into another mode called headphone EQ, and it just measured from the headphones directly into the microphones. So with that, it had about all the information it needed. Oh, it did the room calibration saying, look over to your left, look over to the center, look over to your right, and went through about 5 minutes of sweeps for each of the positions. So now it's got all the information that it needs. I can play any material through my CD player and my receiver, or even you know, just somebody brings a CD, I can put it on and I get the sound of it no matter where I am of this listening room. I get the sound of it, sound of my room and speakers. And why would you want to do that, it says here. Imagine that you're on a cruise ship and you want to enjoy headphone listening to your home system. With this, you can just put on the headphones, put a record in, and listen to it as though it's on your home system. A DVD or Blu-ray, anything you want. It does have to be processed up like my system did from 2.0 to 7.1 for stereo, but I could have just set my system for 2.0 and listened to that and had the realizer record that. Or I could have put that information just down again, put it in a separate memory in the realizer, then I could have a choice. But another reason we might want is want to compare a friend's system to our own. We can take this over to Gary's place and sit down and do the calibration on his MagnaPans, and I'd have them like a photograph, and I could play on my own system anything I wanted and get the sound of Gary's speakers and room. Okay? Now, more practical, and the business I think they're actually in, is if you're making a film and you've recorded sound and you want to do a film mix, you can do it on a computer and at home, but you really are missing the dubbing stage, and you want to have the sound of the place. The picture may be okay, but if you're working on the sound, you want the sound of the dubbing stage. So that's what it can, that's what it should be able to do. That's its goal.
Can you download impulse responses from the libraries on the internet to use with this?
I don't know. I know they have one default one that they normally supply, and I would think they'd be quite a business in it. Do you know about it?
Last time I ran across this type of operation was one of our meetings that somebody was describing how to take a bee and run it around your head from a monoral source with equalization curves.
Take a right on his head?
Years ago. I mean, we had a single source spot with digital conversion and all the calculations of the sound we hear from above, below, around us. He had a computer program that ran these formulas that could take a source and run a bee around your head from a single speaker, and it made you sensitive around you, over you, and by you. And this is a
You're calling it a bee. I heard click. Yeah.
You know, and you had the impression it was rolling around.
This is very much related to that.
Yeah.
Yes, I remember having demonstrations, seen demonstrations like that, and for me, they never worked.
These guys were comparing it and running it past us at one of the Smoot-Ems meetings. Did anybody remember that one?
No, but I remember some Audio Engineering Society meetings where people were demonstrating effects.
Cooper and Bach, I think.
X something. It didn't work. The front never worked for me. And I've been to other head-related transfer function demonstrations where it never worked for me. So having this Smith seem to work is quite something to pay attention to.
Dr. Petronas did in-ear monitors with the microphone right up against your eardrum and ran a frequency curve on our own hearing.
Mm-hmm.
So I got that chart from one of the Synodcom meetings with Don Davis and Carolyn Davis, and it was Dr. Petronas did most research on this, and Ben Koch was there, and Ed Long. And that was like a week-long meeting in Atlanta. It's like loudspeaker design workshop that we had, and we did the intensive in-ear microphoning and sweeping, and what you hear from behind you and in front of you are typically distance tracking between the two ears where a sound wave goes past you, but it's also a frequency curve that varies from behind, above, and below. It's the frequency curves that you can put into a program, and if you slowly adjust that while taking a single source and you can run a sound around the room. Every once in a while I catch this on TV where you think the phone's ringing up here or over here or down here. Somebody's been playing with that equalization curve to try to draw it out into the room itself.
Yeah, well,
three-dimensional.
There's a lot of work that I'm aware of going on with this and of different quality of results. And this is the first time I've heard something that does takes a pretty small part of this field that you're talking about, sets a goal, and seems to accomplish it. This will, in fact, in the horizontal plane, if you turn on certain speakers on the remote control right out and back, if you turn on just certain ones, the sound will seem to come from them. And if you just had pink noise playing or clicks playing or whatever playing in my listening room, I think that you would hear the sound going around your head.
Clicks?
That's what we're talking about, a bee or a click or something.
Well, a bee is not as a click. Somebody was just describing to me where the beepers, the pagers, are a single tone. For some reason, we don't have a location device that will tell where that is, and it's very disconcerting.
Yes, we do.
Well, where I read that, I don't know.
Well,
I've read enough about it to know that other people have said that we can detect an interrupted tone.
Interrupted tone. It gives us some...
Well, a tone that's either there continuously forever and never shuts off, or it's interrupted.
Like the beepers at McDonald's, you know, when they go off and the fries are over.
Make the sound for me.
It's that one disturbing, it's one you hear all the time, but it's constant. I don't know, I just caught that a couple of weeks ago. It was non-directional. Well,
unless you can explain it, we should go on.
Right.
So, this is something within that whole field that seems for me to do a very good job of accomplishing something very difficult. I've heard a lot of attempts. I've heard some impressive binaural, where they use a dummy head mannequin over here with microphones in the ears, and you're transported to what the dummy head hears. I've heard that be impressive, but not quite everything I wanted. Didn't quite have the out of head and the naturalness, and usually not the ability to move your head, but this has the ability to move your head too, and it works. They have a test mode in this that you can set up in software, and you take the headphones and tilt them forward so that the beam tracker beam doesn't work anymore, and the speakers come on. Huh. And would you believe that I find it very difficult to tell the difference between listening to headphones only and listening to speakers only?
Oh, that's going to be fun.
Yeah, I'm not the only one either. But
I heard this too. It's remarkable.
Was it recalibrated with your ears that he made the recording?
Yeah, he calibrated with his ears.
He had his ears and room recorded, and I recorded my ears and room. My calibration worked better for me than his, but his was still generally there.
Does that imply a smaller difference ear to ear than...
Yeah, they were allowing for big differences ear to ear, and head shape to head shape and so forth, and they can accommodate that, but it does work fairly well if my head and the ears are about average, just out in the backyard.
And how many cocktails were required?
Pardon me?
How many cocktails were
This was a zero cocktail event.
No. That requires equalization changes above 4K. It rolls off at 6 dB per octave with 2 beers or 2 aspirin. So
to go through this procedure required cocktails later. Then you definitely had to have them. Okay, so the components of the Realizer. I didn't talk about the DVD player and the Yamaha preamplifier and the speakers in my room. They're just normally hooked up. These are the things that you insert that are the Realizer. So there's an 8-channel A to D converter for signal input. That is analog signal in. They have converters that convert it into a digital format. They also have a new one that has HDMI in, so it bypasses the converters. Then there are a pair of in-ear microphones that just go in here. There is a head tracker, which is a device on your headphones that sends a beam to this. It senses acceleration of your head. And therefore position, and sends it to a receiver mounted on the Smith unit.
It's like the Wii games, right?
The Wii?
Anything that senses motion that interfaces with the games consoles nowadays?
Yeah.
That makes it a lot cheaper. I mean, the technology's out there to interface with this thing.
Yeah, because I've seen head trackers or listen to head trackers before, but they always were sort of an option and sort of high-end and this kind of thing. Now these just little lightweight battery-powered things just seem to do it automatically. So the head tracker monitors head rotation. A processor modifies signals with the information. So you're streaming signals of information from your 7.1 receiver. You're going to process them according to this head tracker information and also the HRTF, head-related transfer function information, that you record with the microphones in your ears. This processing is going to end up going into two channels out for left and right for the pair of high quality headphones. So there's a it said an A-channel D to A converter for signal out. It's probably a two-channel D to A converter because it's already reduced to two there.
I got a question. Do the headphones have just two transducers in them? Mm-hmm. They don't have front and rear transducers?
No.
Really? So that's really clever, I think.
Bring back the four-channel costs.
I don't know how they get four and a half information with just two things side by side. What's the basic logic of it?
The basic logic is that the measurements are made at the entry to your ear canal, and that's replicated by the headphones.
I know, but you don't have enough. You only have dimensional information this direction. You don't have anything in this direction.
You don't have that when you are listening either.
You're making an assumption.
That's a good enough answer.
You're making an assumption about what's important.
Yeah.
And that's not important.
So in fact, these are.
Electrostatic transducers and very wide range, especially when they're closely coupled to your ear. I don't know what this model costs, but I've seen Stax headphones costing $1,000. So they don't need woofers and tweeters.
Are you stuck with these headphones?
No, but you paid for them, so you might as well use them. But no, you can plug any kind of headphones in. It's just when you do the headphone EQ operation with the headphones on,
okay. They'll
be different from the EQ for the Stax.
Okay. So the microphone lies within the headphone itself?
No, the microphone goes in your ear and a wire comes down.
Okay, so
if you want to put the headphones on, you can. They capture your ears and the wire.
One with the speakers, one with the headphones.
Right.
So obviously you can't use earbuds as headphones. When setting this up.
Well, you could, but they're so unstable as how they sit in your ear that I think you would get unstable results.
I think in principle you could get, if you always put them in properly,
couldn't have the microphones.
Yeah, wouldn't have the microphone.
You can't do the ones that are inserted into your canal because the recording's not set up for that.
Yeah, what you'd have to do is you'd have to enter a curve that you made on a coupler of the insert earphones themselves. Or you'd have to put an even smaller microphone.
See, that's what I was getting to, the smaller microphone within. So you're creating that chamber. And you have to record that chamber.
It's done all
for the
time.
First pass, and then you record the room with the speakers in it for the second pass.
The Smith research literature points out that recordings at the eardrum itself are possible and have been done by other workers. They didn't want to include it in this product because of the risk of positioning a microphone at your eardrum.
Good point.
Bob Schulein is another one that I've been in contact with who insists on recording at the eardrum. And David Gressinger is another one that records at the eardrum. So it's quite doable, reasonably popular, except you don't want to just jam any old thing into your eardrum.
That's very clever.
So anyway, I think there are some clever compromises in this thing where they have said actually recording the pinna response twice or ear canal resonance twice in this way, and because the microphones are at the entrance of the ear canal, they do not block it. So they record the 3 kilohertz or so resonance in the ear canal, but they do it twice. And the effect in practice is so small that they say go ahead and listen to it. If you think it's okay, it is okay. If you think it needs to be changed, they offer a little EQ that you can do to get rid of some of that. And I think that's a wise choice because, well, it seemed to work. And listening I've done, I don't feel a need to go back and correct for that. But you're smiling. You would, huh?
No, I'm just thinking this. You could easily change that in the digital domain with a simple program, correctly?
That's what it said. That's what they do.
It's and it has that computer layout. You can just.
It's in the box.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
It's in there. Yeah.
In the box you saw in the picture.
This is
the instruction is about a quarter of an inch thick.
You could put people in environments that, whoa.
Well,
this is just getting started here. Virtual reality.
Moving right along. One thing that they talk about, Smith talks about briefly in this upcoming presentation of theirs, is convolution. And it's really key to this whole thing. And convolution is a mathematical concept, which two signals are combined in a specific way. And without trying to recall, I learned it as analog convolution, as the convolution integral, but basically it applies to digital too, where you take a, let's say a reverberation impulse, or you excite a room with an impulse and capture it dying away, digitize that, and now you have the impulse response of the room. And if you turn that around backwards, which you can do in digital, and multiply the first sample of, you know, your 48 kilohertz, 24 bit or whatever, your first sample by the entire backwards, each element by the entire backwards impulse response, which maybe is 5 seconds long, you'll get a reverberation out of it. That's the result of convolving. And in fact, one way to look at convolving is that with me talking, you've got my pure voice plus the reverberation this the room has added, and you can say that the room is convolved with my voice. So you end up doing this and creating the reverberation, the times of direct arrival, the effect of turning your head, and so on and so forth. So convolution's been known and used a long time, but it's very computation intensive, and that's what makes something like this possible. You know, it used to be to convolve a couple of elements, one 2 seconds long, another a few tenths of a second long. You'd hit go on your computer, go make a cup of coffee and come back and see if it was done. Now it's doing something way more than that in real time because computers are so fast. So a music signal is about an hour of 24-bit, say 48 kilohertz samples. The other signal can be the impulse response to the listening room reverberation at a point. 5 seconds of 24-bit, 48 kilohertz is probably necessary. The output is, the convolution is music. Ah, complexity, that's what I wanted to read you. So each sample has to be multiplied 48,000 times in 1/48,000th of a second. Then it moves on to the next sample, 1/48,000th of a second, and has to multiply each of those 48, 5 seconds of 48,000 samples. So if you do the math, you end up with 250,000 multiplications in a 48,000th of a second. And that pretty soon gets into MIPS, or million instructions per second. And the processor has to do this in quasi real time. There's actually a 16 millisecond delay, but it has to do this in real time for all 8 channels at once, and 2 output channels, and interpolate the head tracking measurements that you made at the 3 position, of if you're halfway in between, as to interpolate and use this one and throw that in there as a modified impulse response that's going to do. So there's a lot of complexity in it.
Can I ask you a quick question on that part? Are the 3 positions maintained separately, or are they reduced to 1 curve to assess a radius that you move your head through? I'm trying to think of how it would be implemented.
They're maintained separately. Okay. And when you have your head dead center, it just uses the one that you measured when it was centered.
So this thing's going to know your head position in some way?
Yeah, it does. Okay. It's what you wear a thing.
It's got the sensor in there that will also do the head position that way.
Bluetooth, whatever it is, radio transmits it, but it finds it by sensing acceleration. And acceleration can, that's what they say it senses, and that if you integrate it twice, turns into position.
Sure.
So if you turn midway between the 2 points that you recorded, it does an interpolation. Now, it has to do this in a pretty smart way. It really has to move the frequency of a band to a different place of a notch, typically, instead of just saying, here it was high, here it was low, therefore we'll give you in between. You have to say, here it was high frequency, here it was lower frequency, we'll give you the same notch, but a in-between frequency. So it's not just amplitude interpolation. It's at least I know to do it right, it's not simple amplitude interpretation.
What about phase in this?
Phase is very much a part of all this automatically.
Yeah.
When I turn my head getting a phase difference between these 2 ears.
We can vector map that and do it rapidly with computing.
Yeah, okay. This is the start of Laura Kramer's presentation, finally, which may move a bit too fast. He talks about interaural time difference and interaural level difference. Interaural means between the 2 ears. And he shows that they may very well be different. And the scale on here is roughly one millisecond. Is this? It's about an inch of position there. Because I recognize these things, and that's what you see. See this difference in initial start time between here and here is the distance to go around here, or from one side to the other, which is actually it's a little off. Somewhere around 600 microseconds for all that. And here they're centered, and there's no delay, and here there's a delay. Okay, so this is the kind of information that it's looking for. And head tracking, boy, it's easier for me to look at this than it is my little screen.
Thank you, Harry.
Yeah, well, this should just be up here. There would be no problem. It's just saying that when you move your head, the image tends to stay still because of this. And this is showing something that I think we all know, that sound from real loudspeaker comes both by a direct path that's shown in red, by a pink path that's early reflections, and through reverberation, which is shown as the dash cylindrical thing. So he likes to separate it into those, and he captures all of them in what he's doing. Now this shows the impulse response. I should mention that you hear a sine wave sweep. You know, it's what goes into your ear. That can very simply be converted into an impulse response. So without even mentioning that he's doing that, that's what he's done also. So direct reflections, the little spiky thing, reverberation in this tail. Yeah, this one took some staring at for me. This is direct sound blown up here in this oval. And personalization important for spatialization. Strong reflection. Well, he doesn't have anything for that. But then reverberation, personalization important for timbre. Well, okay. So he's just claiming that they do it long enough to capture everything that's important. These are the measurements at the three angles that I mentioned, and they do show the interaural time difference getting offset. Also, you can tell by the waves that there's some change in the frequency response as well. Now the realizer, two stages, I'm not so sure. SDS is Smith something systems, I forget right now. But at any rate, we have a built-in test generator that generates those little sounds and provides synchronization. Then you put the microphones in your ear, left ear, right ear, and deconvolve. That's I'm not so sure what he means by that.
The process of turning the sine sweep into an impulse response.
Is deconvolving? Okay. So they do this operation right. There.
PRIR is the personalized impulse response that you get out of the deconvolve step.
Out of a what?
Out of the deconvolution.
Yeah. Okay. So this is one of their key quantities, PRIR. And then I guess this is input, and the convolution process takes place where these two signals are, now it's a PRIR, which is contains the information that you receive that's convolved, again, with this two-channel material. There's a two-channel DAC, and you hear it. Stage 2, multi-channel convolution engine with integrated dynamic head tracking. Okay, I guess they just added the head tracker here to already what they had already in the first slide. So that's pretty much what I've been talking about. This reference room supplied by user, all that stuff, or just anybody she can get some time in. And, well, use the method I went through to capture the data.
Saw that.
Yeah, it looks like the same thing.
Just bigger. Taking advantage of Gary's TV.
Okay. Yes. Oh, I know what I did. Oh, okay. I'm just, we're at the end of this. There's his picture of the headphones on a wig dummy or something, and accelerometer package and the IR receiver package. So if we have more than 8 channels, like in real film mixing, they'll be happy to sell you more, and they have a way of combining them. And then basically, here's his list of what it's all good for, which pretty much have covered. So that's it. That's hopefully I did okay with Randy and Laura and presented their view on it. Any questions?
How much does this thing cost?
About $3,000.
Including the headphones.
Mm. You get the stacks for that?
Yeah. Wow. Stacks headphones. Yeah, I think that's as professional equipment, we paid $3,000 for tape recorder and a bunch of Pultec equalizers back in the days of Motown, and paid $3,000 for reverberation chambers from Germany that were EMT metal plate reverb units, and this is a high price for the early adopters as soon as it becomes technically feasible, and but if you need it now, you don't have to wait till it comes down, I guess.
Yeah. Well, the other thing is that this won't allow, you'll have to take this box with you anywhere you go in order to benefit from this system. Not just the headphones, but you have to bring the box too.
So jogging with my iPod, thought I'd have
to. Yeah.
So that was going to be my question.
Then you have to wear the headphones.
Does it require 110, you know, line voltage or battery power?
Well, you know, let's just...
You're not taking it to the beach, yeah.
Details. You can get 110 volts anytime you want it. If not, I'll be happy to take your money and give it to you.
Could you copy the encoded output into your iPod for use remotely?
God, you don't get the kind of computer power, do you?
Copy the encoded output into an iPhone application?
Instead of going to your headphones,
You could, I know Tom won't like this, but you could pre-process this. Previous to your going on your steamship cruise, you could always process a bunch of your stuff.
But you would be able to turn your...
All you had to take was a memory stick, and you didn't have to take this terrible box that's this big.
Relatively compact for us doing.
You wouldn't get the tracking, though.
Right.
You'd have to give up tracking.
That's no big deal.
We have the sensor mounted on a laptop. That'll be an application for an iPod. Just let them go on your head, stick the iPhone on, and you've got a head tracker.
A little tracking device on yourself. Smart. Yeah, on top of that. So whatever that is.
I don't feel the right person to ask this from watching your reaction at the AES meeting, but this theory about the room borders affecting your ability to your acoustics in the binaural recording beyond those dimensions. Does this overcome that? Or
no, it doesn't. It picks them up and just includes them. So that's just a theory of mine about the importance of the room borders. But if it's true, it's no problem for this thing because they're recorded, their influence is recorded anyway.
Yeah. It's characterized when he does the reverb measurements.
Pardon me?
Characterized when he does the reverb measurements.
Yeah. When you do reverb, head, and pinna, and everything with these microphones, plus speaker locations, all of that is done at the same time. It's just one file, this PRIR file. And that becomes an impulse, and that impulse is convolved, and it is about 5 seconds long. That impulse is convolved in real time with the incoming signal, 8 channels, and then it's modified by the head tracker, and that's...
But if you set this up in a big room like this and you sit in your library half the size and listen, does that other phenomena get in the way of this, or do you hear the big room?
Oh, you don't have speakers on, or at least not very loudly when you're listening to the headphones.
I think you're not getting a communication.
Yeah, I don't think you understood my question. Yeah. You set the screen up so you can hear it as it's coming from these speakers in this big room. Now you go into the other room that's small, and you listen to the headphones in there.
You will hear the big room with the big speakers.
Do you hear it as if you were in a big room?
Dave, that's the whole idea.
The whole idea is transference of listening environment to another environment without changing the environment.
There's another aspect.
Okay.
This other lecture was saying that mentally your brain refuses to accept sound from beyond the dimensions of the environment you know you're in.
Oh, but what
was their premise?
The way Brady
was. So are
you saying this thing is disputing their premise?
Yes, it does dispute their premise. I dispute their premise also because I've spent years developing sound systems for cars. And one of the things that's expected of them is that the sound seems to come from outside beyond the confines of the car. If it doesn't do that, it isn't working. Mm-hmm. And so experience has led me to dispute Wade Bray's premise. I hear sound on the other side of a wall easily, even when it's done. Yep.
Okay, does anybody remember ever been in the Disney World Epcot Center at the Foley Artist Studio, where you go into the last room and you go into a little room, you lock it, turns the light off, you put a pair of headphones on, and it recreates the environment entirely by sound with the lights off? Has anybody gone through that experience? Well, the demonstration was so eerie, you could tell where the guy came through a door, walked across here, fired an arrow over your shoulder into the right side of the desk, that you found a desk there, you found a refrigerator, you found a bottle of Coke, wandered across, got opened in front of you, a barber came in, popped a little thing around, put it around your neck, and started shaving the back of your head. This was all done entirely by sound.
Did everybody wear headphones?
Everybody had headphones. There was maybe two people in this little box with you. Mm-hmm. Maybe you just had one or two, but the environment was, to clue you in on what sound could be in an environment in the movie industry that they were really trying to captivate when they put you in a theater. It was a very good demonstration. Very little was made of it. It was just 5 or 6 empty demo rooms at the end of the Foley Artist Studio. And it's the only time I've ever seen that tried to
Well, what they were doing was HRTF over headphones, right?
It was it had to be a full, you know, head, shoulders, ears combination with the in-ear microphones and a pair of maybe just a stereo tracking digital.
No, wait a minute. They did certain things that they could do. And they claim that that's important. That's claim is, you know, maybe not. These people from Smith do certain things that are convenient for them to do and claim they're important. And the claims don't mesh 100%. Doesn't mean that either one is right entirely or either one's wrong entirely. Your guys just did enough. Your guys, for instance, didn't have personalized transfer functions.
Well, it's a pair of headphones just stuck in your ears, basically.
They didn't have...
They cut off the environment
cue by visual. You still need the transfer functions.
And they only give it back to you by audible.
Those are the sort of demonstrations that never worked for me. And this is why I find the Smith to be something different. It's got more processing power. It's doing more things right than some of those earlier demonstrations.
Let's just say your demonstration worked. I'll repeat, it does not use individualized head-related transfer functions.
And that's what makes this one work.
I don't know if that's important or not, but they don't use it.
It wasn't meant to. It was the way it was recorded. It was very simple.
No, you still need the transfer functions in there somewhere. Those demos had a problem for some individuals, including myself.
Sure, they're averaged or something.
Yeah, they'd say, well, try another head-related transfer function. They had none in their kit that worked for me.
The last meeting, somebody played back in the basement, we were playing back a pair of visual cues through audio because it was recorded with the head and he was walking around the room and the audible cues trying to come back through a speaker was not there.
No,
putting on a pair of headphones and creating an environment through all these digital cues.
You're just taking a little number of facts.
It's great.
And you're making
some people that works right away, and that probably includes yourself. There are other people like me where it doesn't work. We need the better processing that comes in today.
Well, I see what they're doing.
If your system always worked, you wouldn't need this Smith.
It was a demonstration. You're doing something totally entirely different. I just wanted to make a point.
It's the same science.
The American public's being introduced to what sound environment to transfer a person to that environment.
Yeah, well, it doesn't work.
And this is
it's not reliable enough. It's been around for years and years and years and has never made it into a product.
Okay, has anybody been Back to the Future ride down there too in Universal Studios?
Well, that's a very special effect situation.
And how is that reproduced?
They make it work.
Multiple speakers.
Yeah.
Right, but it changed your environment. Audible, visual, they changed your environment. They swept you in another location. What you're trying to do here is take yourself in a remote location and sweep yourself back into an environment you like listening to it in. And introducing whatever music you want to introduce that time back into the environment you were created and you love to listen to music in. This is what this whole focus is. It's creating an environment you can listen to something in that ignores the environment you're in at the moment.
Reproduces
the ultimate achievement here.
It reproduces an environment.
If you can close your eyes, you'll forget the room around you and you'll be transported back to the room you listened to it originally. And this is the whole focus of this. He's right about having the visual cues come in to the point where you can't agree with the visual cues plus the audible cues you're seeing with the headset. You can't agree with the room.
Russell, have you listened to this demo?
I have to. I really do. This intrigues me.
Dennis, named a hypothesis. Nothing wrong with that.
Absolutely.
Hypothesis come and go. And it's just, I've had evidence that this one isn't true. And, you know, I've talked to Wade about it, and he has evidence that it is true. So I guess we do more experiments with Wade.
I have one question. Who's Smith?
Yeah. Apparently a North Irish person who has a PhD in this sort of thing, and his brother, and some other people, and this is what he does. That's you know, his biography is on the website.
Just
type Smith with a Y and Realizer, and you get the whole scoop on a pretty compact little website.
Just for the record, having heard his demonstrations, I did hear what he was talking about, but I also found that I could overcome it easily. So it might be something to do with your training, or just like Dave said, the differences in people's reaction because of the different head-related transfer functions from person to person. Maybe there's an individual aspect to this thing that's vulnerable to it and who isn't.
I agree, attitude is all important. And Thomas Satan has such a bad attitude. I don't expect anything more for him.
By the same token, Wade's demonstration didn't involve personalized transfer functions the way this system does either. So it may be a matter of the fact that because that wasn't personalized to you, you could overcome it. You may or may not be able to overcome one that was personalized to you on this system.
I think Shuline feels that he gets a transfer function in. But the you don't have the head-related transfer, or the tracking thing. And he uses ad eardrum recording and well, I forget what all, but he says he captures it with his he blocks the ear canal with a microphone and a little speaker. And the microphone signal goes into the little speaker at the same time. Or if you're just using the insert earphones, it and you've recorded it with the microphone, it replays into that earphone, so it has the elements of the head-related elements, but no head tracking. Well, this is
thank you.
One of the few things I've seen that's been interesting in audio recently. Thank you.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.